soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Soy loco por ti de amores. Soy loco por ti, América. Loco por ti de amores.
Hello everyone and welcome to this cycle of seminars organized by AICA, Technical Cooperation Institute. AICA has had a very proactive role during these times, trying to bring clear thoughts and a view to a strategy to the scenario coming after COVID. Part of their actions include this cycle of seminars on the world food security in Latin America after COVID-19. This being now the fourth session of the seminar, looking at effects on international trade and health regulations of COVID-19. We are joined by Ms. Anabel González and Mr. Cassio Luiselli. Ms. Anabel González is senior researcher of the Peterson Institute for International Economics in Washington, D.C., international consultant on trade, investment, and economic development, including for AICA. She has previously worked as senior director on global commerce and competitiveness at the World Bank. She has been a minister of foreign trade in Costa Rica, director of the Division of Agriculture at the WTO, and worked at the IDB, among others. Dr. Cassio Luiselli is currently an associate researcher of the Program for Development in the Autonomous University of Mexico and Emeritus Professor of the Monterrey Technological Institute. He is also a postgraduate professor in the Mora Institute, economist under UNAM, with a doctor's degree in Wisconsin University, with a specialization in agricultural economy and international affairs. With that, I welcome you both. Thank you for joining us today, talking about these very relevant matters, not just for Latin America and the Caribbean, but for the whole world. Thank you, Silvia. It's a pleasure for me to be here. Thank you to AICA for the invitation. It's truly a pleasure to be here today with Cassio and Silvia. I would like to begin with some reflections. Thinking first about what was going on before this COVID shock, because that also gives us what playing field we had before the coronavirus came. There, it's important to highlight that new technologies, trade confrontations, and the new geopolitics had redefined or were redefining worldwide economy. So investment policies were also changing quickly. Even though there were different scenarios at hand, the global trade scenario was being hit by three factors. First, what we could call the reactivation of administered trade, policy centering on the return of tariffs, on voluntary restrictions to imports and others that were being used by some countries to achieve the national security objectives they had, as well as political objectives. This was complemented with other policies in investment and controls on imports. It wanted to dissociate the United States from the Chinese economy in that great rivalry that existed geopolitically and the systemic differences among both nations. A second factor that was part of that previous scenario was the fragmentation of trade rules. There were a series of new agreements or revision of existing agreements, although some being very important to serve as a basis for global value chains. Some partial agreements tended to delve deeper into the administered trade and to erode the non-discrimination concept. So with that, we had the third part, which is the weakness of global trade governance. Here we know that the WTO was going through important issues. First, because of the adoption of national security tariffs by the United States and the response by other member countries, as well as the paralyzation of the organ of appeals of the WTO. But in the end, there were concerns, and there still are serious concerns, that affected the functioning of the system, including how to redefine the playing field to better address state intervention in markets through subsidies, state enterprises, forced technology adoption, and what measures are necessary for governance of economic trade, particularly e-commerce, and also given the role of emergent economies in world trade, what they would contribute to that. So the WTO had great pressures. The business environment had become quite volatile and uncertain, and the trade in agricultural products, of course, is not exempt from these tensions. It's actually one of the arenas where that big confrontation came with the main countries in the world. Increases in tariffs and more subsidies introduced new elements of distortion. So in that context is when we have coronavirus come in, and it had a devastating impact on global trade, economy, commerce, poverty. According to estimates internationally, in 2020, the global economy will decrease by 3%. Global trade could fall by 13 to 32%, foreign investment could be reduced to 30 or 40%, and about 50 million people could land in extreme poverty. For example, then, a country like Colombia in a year would have all its population in extreme poverty. And the impact of coronavirus on food security in populations that already had nutritional deficiencies could lead to more hunger in the world. So, to conclude, we have to think about the role of trade in all this. The first thing we've seen is a great disruption of global value chains. This is a result, on the one hand, of the forced reduction of production, given the measures that have been necessary to contain the virus. And on the other hand, the impact of those measures on the demand of goods and services, as well as maritime, air, and land transport affected, and the whole uncertainty in context of investment and businesses. In the agricultural sector, if we look at it, although the social distancing measures have affected the essential character of production, and there's been disruptions in transport, availability of labor to harvest, access to inputs like fertilizers. And here, trade policies have helped in a way. Some countries have reduced tariffs. They've implemented green channels to allow passing through customs. But some countries have also adopted restrictions to exports, including 17 of these specifically in food products, especially countries in Eastern Europe and Asia. So this brings the risk that along with the health crisis and the economic crisis, there could be a food crisis when we have solid foundations, really, in the sense that food is there. The supply of food is abundant. But of course, there could be an impact given the factors I've mentioned, transport and other measures. So this would be it for my first intervention, so we can continue the conversation. I think it's really interesting, Anabel. It's great to be here with you and to share the conversation with you. I have to say that I assiduously follow your page at the Institute, your webpage, and I really respect the Peterson Institute. It helps me find ideas even for my classes. I agree, and Annabelle's narrative is quite similar to what I had prepared as well. I think that, yes, we are living a delicate time. The structure of world trade, the institutionality of world trade. Director Acevedo, I don't know the specific reasons, but his leaving alarmed me particularly. Also, the American Senator Hawley, that is asking to abolish the WTO. That's not going to prosper, but we have those voices, and they are allowed a space because Trump is letting them open up and say these things. So given that context, as Anabel said, there is a clear geopolitical context. It's very complex, and we have that clash between China and the United States. And us in Latin America, at AICA, and the food world, we have to clearly understand that background. Because the issue of China and the United States affects us very directly. I don't want to repeat some of the things that Anabel has already said so clearly, but Latin America is facing the crisis with a deglobalization. So there's two Latin Americas, if you will, and they're very clearly differentiated. You have South America that is becoming primary, relatively, of course, this is all relative. It's deindustrializing, given the brutal impact of Chinese demand for commodities. So there's a commoditization of South America. Soy is a paradigmatic case. But there's many other products that are changing the South American economy. And on the other hand, we have Mexico. And in a way, Central America, especially Costa Rica. They are more part of the global chains in a different economic logic. In the case of Mexico, with more contributions of technology, leaving behind that simple maquila factory model, trying to be more industrial. And now you see the risks. There's risks on two sides. First, the deindustrialization in the south, the privatization in the south, and the long complex chains in other countries such as Mexico. So the question is, where do we want to place ourselves? How can we face this clear downturn of the globalization? I see that there is a hiatus in the global process, and I don't think globalization will disappear completely. New technologies certainly favor globalization. Even us now talking through Zoom is an example. But there is a manifest risk, and now even more so with COVID, for certain chains, especially the supply of weapons. And as Anabel says, the WTO is documenting many obstacles to trade of medical inputs. And it can be understood because, of course, countries first try to maintain their own stocks of medical supplies. This also goes along with pressure on the agri-food world. Agriculture is one of the first things that are protected, especially certain products. And we need to understand that. So although the world supply is abundant, and ministers of agriculture of the G20 have made a commitment to keep markets opened, and they've made a call for that, for agri-food inputs, there is still that risk. And behind that risk, we have that geopolitical tension that we have to understand clearly. I think that we also need to try to understand the scenario. Of course, we have much uncertainty, but we have to try and see a way out. Some are already presenting this, but there's many questions. Will there be a second peak of the virus in winter? Having that herd contagion happen is very... herd immunization happen is under debate because there's already many people infected. Yes, for that immunization, we would need 85% of the population. So if we want herd immunity, it's a complicated case as well. So we have very complex scenarios at hand. So we'd have to see how we can reinforce food systems. As Anabel said, especially given the interruptions in the mobility of persons at work, that harvest, and also impacts on transport and logistics. We should actually congratulate the systems that are still open. It's wonderful, but the risks and threats are there. And again, we have that concerning geopolitical background. I'd like to delve into that precisely, the geopolitical background, because it has been stronger in the past weeks. And the fact that Mr. Acevedo has left the WTO complicates things with a landscape that was already complex. There is even more tension between the United States and China that is not going away, especially looking at the fact that there's a coming campaign or electoral times in the United States, and Trump is using that in his favor. And this affects world trade. No country, no society is self-sufficient in terms of food. They all need trade. How will this affect that post-COVID era? Thank you, Sylvia. As you and Cassio have highlighted, we know that this geopolitical tension is at the very core of what we are living today. However, I do want to say that I believe that in the post-COVID scenario, international cooperation in the trade area is absolutely essential. It is essential because we want to avoid policy measures that might seem attractive from a perspective of just looking at the policy, but that are actually counterproductive. They will also be necessary, the cooperation will be necessary to reduce or eliminate some measures that have already been negative in their impact. And it will also be important to look at these drastic changes that COVID-19 has brought. Let us look at the example of restrictions to exports. This is a type of measure that sometimes is natural, as Cassio mentioned. Countries, of course, want to guarantee supplies for their own population, and the best way to do it is closing borders, or at least it's thought. The truth is that that is a very detrimental, especially, well, first, of course, for the importers, the importing countries not having access to medical supplies, protection equipment, or even food. Of course, we'll be impacted just by that. But even for the exporting country themselves, it's not positive because there's a de-incentivization of production. There are no incentives on new production. It leads to higher prices. And then other countries could retaliate against these measures. So in the short and medium term, this might seem like a good policy. But if you think about it in the medium to longer term, this policy is very counterproductive. Precisely to look at those pressures, collaboration internationally is fundamental. I think that a place like the WTO is ideal, is an ideal place for that cooperation to happen. However, if it is not possible to have global cooperation, given the reasons we've just heard by Sylvia and Cassio, I think that countries that are willing to cooperate should take the initiative. And there we've seen quite interesting examples. For example, New Zealand and Singapore have reached an agreement they have opened to other countries to guarantee the free flow of essential goods and to maintain value chains open. The same goes for Canada and other 22 members of the WTO, including a series of Latin American countries. They've adopted an agreement to guarantee open and predictable trade in agri-food products. So there are initiatives. We are seeing this happen. And this cooperation will be necessary to fight the wave of the pandemic. We're still here in the midst of it, and we could have new waves coming, precisely because we know that it's not so simple to have herd immunity. So this cooperation will be vital to recover from the pandemic, to maintain the supply chains moving, trade channels open, to guarantee that there's a flow of funding for trade, and also to facilitate flows of investments. And it's also important for the reconstruction of the future, especially here if we look at agricultural trade. There are risks derived from new distortions to trade. that some markets are introducing of non-tariff barriers that might lead to more restricted health measures, for example, an increase of distortions to production and imports. So the countries in Latin America should pay close attention to these challenges we see, trying to find what internal policy measures they can take to minimize this, how they can cooperate in the regional sphere and the global sphere, and then also identify opportunities. Because within this tragedy that we have as coronavirus, we could have opportunities for countries in the region. For example, if we look at it, Latin America, how can it see itself? It can see itself as positioning as a trusted provider of safe food, guaranteeing quality and food safety, convincing consumers from importing countries that they can be sure that the products coming from our region meet certain standards. So, yes, it is a convulsive time in the world. The situation is complex. There's plenty of challenges, but we have opportunities. And for that, we necessarily need cooperation. Ideally, it would be global cooperation, but if not possible, we have to find it at the regional level. How can we guarantee safety within a sustainable production, friendly with the environment, all the requirements we see lately, and which are all relevant for countries in trying to export or positioning themselves as a safe, healthy exporter to guarantee those buying products that your products are safe and also eco-friendly? Well, before I answer that question, I will continue on the broader topic of Latin America, and then I can go to safety. At this time, politically speaking, it's essential for Latin America to defend the WTO. The WTO is a complex multilateral construction. It is difficult, yes, but it is necessary, and we need it working. And based on that, we can build forward. Three countries of ours are in the G20. That's an important pool. But all of Latin America should fight for a working WTO. For me, there are two crucial internal tasks in Latin America: internal cooperation and advancing in integration. Very specifically, advancing in our own chain, our integration chains. And I'm not just talking about agricultural chains, although we are focusing on those now. As Anabel said, and also Sylvia, in our continent, we have great production of food. There is enormous potential. Just Brazil has 1 billion square kilometers available to broaden that agricultural frontier. And we know that the Atlantic, South America, Argentina, Paraguay, and Uruguay have wonderful lands. The rest of the continent has great potential for different types of agriculture. We also have extraordinary institutions. Of course, I don't know all of them, but I know that there's traceability of beef in Uruguay. It's quite impressive, even worldwide. I know there's an efficient and recognized institution in Embrapa in Brazil, in Senasica in Mexico, also working closely in food safety and health. EICA has a crucial role to play there, connecting the dots. EICA can be precisely the interlocutor, bringing those great institutions together. I've just mentioned a few. I'm sure there are others, and many can benefit from that. So their cooperation and integration are important elements. Additionally, we can advance in technical reserves. The World Food Program can work with us. We have 2 or 3 delicate issues in the continent, or delicate points. Haiti, a country that we have to help generously and with uninterested help. There are some areas in the dry corridor of Central America that also need our help, and of course the case of Venezuela, especially if we have populations along borders. We need to work together and cooperate with that. Institutions as ALADI, that I know very well because I was a representative of Mexico and presided that, it's a very important institution. And it is not always mentioned in these circumstances. If the WTO is not working for us, ALADI could work for us quite well, in the region at least. So we have to ensure that we maintain trade flows open and can work through that institution. As for food safety, the institutions I've mentioned, the institutions of excellency we have in the continent, can help us make this a generalized view for the region. In Mexico, we created SENASICA, given the need to do so, considering the restrictions from US and Canada that are very stringent in terms of food safety. So we can cooperate greatly amongst ourselves. Lastly, we should not forget that COVID arrives at a very bad time for Latin America. I mean, we were not doing great. We were doing seeing a 2020 that would see little growth. And this horizon now complicates things much further. So we need to increase dialogue and cooperation in the region. And I think EICA, from its niche, from its work, can serve as an essential pivot for this. You've said that COVID comes at a difficult time for Latin America, and the WHO has said that COVID is not going anywhere, it's here to stay. And this is a world we have to live in now, we have to learn to live in. In the same, we have to learn to trade and grow in this world. How can we ensure food security in the region? How to help a region that was going through difficulty, that will see that difficulty growing larger with more poverty? How can we guarantee food security? I think that world or international trade is a fundamental element of food security. It allows food to move from the places of production to the places of consumption. Of course, different countries have different balances between national production and international trade. But certainly in the whole world, there's about 20%, a bit less, of people in the world that exclusively depend on international trade for their food. In the case of Latin American countries, we have potential in the agri-food sector for exports. If we think about Brazil, Argentina, that are the first and second exporter in the region and the third and tenth worldwide. But we see other countries as well that have a successful performance in exports in agriculture, countries like Mexico, Chile, Ecuador, Costa Rica, and other Central American countries. So the region certainly has many opportunities in international trade, and it has opportunities to contribute to food security in our own region and the world. But for trade to truly fulfill its role to contribute to food safety and security, that trade has to be exempt from obstacles and restrictions. I've said before that restrictions to exports are very damaging, and we also have restrictions to imports. These also cause great damage. Tariffs can lead to higher prices of food, and non-tariff barriers can also lead to that, or avoid access of the poorest populations to the food. So that I think that in times of crisis like these, it's important to reflect on how countries can contribute through their commercial policies, to support food security. And eliminating hunger is part of the SDGs, but not only that. With or without coronavirus, it's essential. But in the context of coronavirus, where even more pressure can come to food security, we need to work even more closely to ensure that barriers and restrictions to trade do not create larger risks. And this is something we have to think about in the context of WTO, but we can also work on it in different countries and regions, including with the cooperation of institutions like AICA. If we look at non-tariff barriers that we might see, which ones do you believe will come naturally, given the crisis we are going through? I think that non-tariff barriers are going to be there as a permanent threat. One is closing borders, the other is having quotas or having administrative barriers. You could also use supposed health arguments as a true barrier. WTO has extraordinary experience already with these, with different topics. So we can use that experience and adapt it to Latin America, bring it over here. I insist and I agree with Anabel and what you've said, Sylvia, as well. The threat will be there. It won't go away. And we have to be, we have to pay close attention. We have to give more vitality to ELADI. It has an important role to play. Think about it. It's our memory of Latin American integration. We don't have all the countries there, but many countries are part of it. And we can broaden its scope of action. I don't think it is a substitute for the WTO, but if the WTO has problems, reinforcing ELADI will be an important mandate. And actually, CELAC asked for a study on the food security issue. CELAC is kind of a ghost that's there without doing much. We should be able to reactivate it precisely to work on these matters. It's an institution that opens dialogue in the whole region, regardless of political inclinations. So an essential task to meet the needs of maintaining open trade is to revitalize our institutions. And again, AICA there has a clear, precise role to play. I have also, moving the discussion to our matters, I also have to say that countries that are net importers, we have to analyze their situation so that we may better help them, better support them, and cooperate. As Anabel said, we have large exporters. Of course, Brazil is the fourth exporter in the world, if I'm not mistaken. But the others are China, India, and the United States. So Argentina also has great potential. But the whole region, Mexico itself, for many years it was a net importer of foods. Now it is a net exporter. We have an important surplus. We've become a country that exports $50 billion in products, in agri-food products. So we can do it. We have the potential. We have to revise our institutions and find greater dialogue. We have to be also very keen on looking at risks and where non-tariff barriers can come up. This could be worrisome if we have new barriers as well. We also have to look to the Caribbean, and we might bring this up here amongst this group. Miss Anabel said that many economies have changed their model. In the case of Costa Rica, it had an agri-exporting model, and now it's exporting services and other types of manufacturing, needing more technical labor. Should we look again to agriculture? Should agriculture become a priority? Do we need more intensive production? Or as Cassio said, should we look to strengthening WTO, CELAC, ELADI, to make better decisions in international trade? I think that for countries, in a way, it's important to diversify, to have a diversified productive structure. Within that diversification, at least for the countries that have the level of development as Latin American countries do, it's essential to diversify. That diversification should cover, in the case of exports, an industrial part, an agricultural part, and a service component. In many cases, when we're talking about agri-food exports, we also have industry there and services. I believe that many countries in the region have shown that they are successful agro-exporters. We've seen the great transformation of Mexico, for example, with products such as avocado and so many others. We've also seen the case of Costa Rica, a country with important competitive advantages in products such as banana, pineapple, melon, chayote, mango. In that sense, I believe that the region has progressed in a good direction and aligned with comparative advantages they had, or thanks to the introduction of technology, or through a focus of adding value. Of course, even so, we have important challenges. Cassio mentioned the countries of the Caribbean. They certainly have a different situation. But all the countries in the region have a large group of small and medium producers that are not necessarily fully incorporated in these opportunities of international trade. They also lack access to technologies to improve their production practices. And there is an important task that we still have pending: connecting these producers with other producers so they become maybe indirect exporters, or supporting them with certified seeds, or helping them associate themselves for export, bringing knowledge and information on how to access new markets, how to use the international trade platforms, or digital, trade platforms. These are still important challenges in the region. And I go back to what Cassio mentioned on cooperation. And there, institutions such as AICA can continue playing a very valuable role in supporting different countries. So that transformation we've seen in the agri-food sector can reach other groups of society through these types of institutions and cooperation. In some countries, there's been some debate on whether food security being the same as being self-sufficient, producing everything you need, or whether food security comes from a combination of production in the areas where I am stronger and clear rules for healthy commercial trade and exchange. How will the model change? I think there's good points in the model. We just have to broaden it. And I said that we have some institutions of excellence in the region. I've mentioned some I know. I'm sure there are others. We also have relatively successful companies that are international champions. Argentina has a capacity of exporting grain and knowledge in the worldwide grain market that is extraordinary. Chile has been the most successful in the world in the wine chain and grape chain in China. Chileans have done things better than the Europeans in terms of positioning their wine in a complex market such as China. Peruvians, I'm glad to say, have found a great segment in the Mexican market of fruits, using seasonality very well. And Mexico has the company Bimbo, the first or the most important producer of bread in the world. And I'm really glad to see that. I was in Beijing once and I saw Bimbo trucks all around the city of Beijing selling Bimbo products. So as we have institutions of excellence, we also have businesses and enterprises of excellence. If I go to the supermarket and see that there's Lizano sauce that is brought in from Costa Rica, I'm very glad because that means the market is already activated. We just have to delve deeper into it, enhance it. And a dialogue with the business sector has to happen as well. We cannot think that they are a different area and that it is out of reach of institutions such as AICA, for example. We have to help companies bring come to that dialogue and to trade amongst themselves. That's an important role we can play. There's one thing that concerns me a lot, which is the fact that besides we have the virus, that of course has us all with this great impact, we have to think about climate change. And they're actually part of the same. The biosphere is being challenged by the economic system very clearly, and there's no global institutional response to understand it. Latin America is also vulnerable. Imagine the vulnerability of the region if we think about climate change. Much of the region is in the tropics. Think about the vulnerability to natural disasters. We have much of that in the Caribbean side and also Mexico, Central America, and the north of South America. Those are enormous tasks that also call for cooperation. There's a list of tasks that are essential. And I was thinking of AICA because they have a great work agenda to truly move forward in terms of cooperation, understanding that the world that has arrived, as Sylvia said, is not going away. So we might come out of the state of emergency, but I think that pandemics and climate issues are things that we have to think about. It's a matter of our times, and we have to prepare ourselves. We have to prepare institutions for that and to find the cooperation mechanisms to address this. That's why I also think about champion enterprises and businesses. We have good companies here as well. To close, Ms. Anabel, what is the conclusion you draw in the context of food security and what awaits us in international trade in the post-COVID world? It's even now, with COVID present, what conclusions do you draw? The main point I'd like to highlight is the need for cooperation among countries to maintain an open playing field for international trade. Now more than ever, we need products moving from countries that produce them or places of production to the places of consumption and where they're needed. With the pandemic, we probably will find some difficulties, for example, linked to transport, new health requirements, difficulties in terms of controls for the movement of people. But precisely because of that, it is even more important to work together to maintain a flow of value chains and open channels for trade. Countries in Latin America should be leaders in this area, precisely because agricultural trade is so important in the region. In that sense, I would like to see institutions such as AICA decisively supporting the countries in the region to ensure that we have this institutional environment that is robust to favor trade. Thank you, Ms. Anabel, Mr. Cassio. Well, I would probably have to echo the words of Anabel to add to what she's already said very clearly. We need to understand that Latin America has great potential in the agri-food sector. As a continent or sub-region, we are probably the world's food reserve. And I don't say this rhetorically. Just look at the potential we have, the real potential in the continent and others. We see Latin America with great potential, of course. As Anabel said, I believe we need to maintain the trade flows open, supporting the WTO, but also supporting each other, supporting ourselves through the institutions we have to revitalize. And for that, AICA has a central role in terms of cooperation efforts. We should also think about Latin American integration. We should not forget that. Mexico has a border with Guatemala, and Guatemala is a great producer of vegetables. However, trade between Guatemala and Mexico is very small. And there's no reason for this. There's a lot of work to do in trade. Many points and places that could be brought closer. And there, we need cooperation again and integration. So we do have great challenges, but a wonderful potential that can help us act with much strength and force. There are many points that are quite interesting from this conversation, and I'd like to highlight some of those. Latin America has to find a diversification of its productive structure, fighting for strengthening of institutions such as the WTO that is going through a very particular situation and complex matters given the geopolitical situation you've both mentioned at the beginning. We have to strengthen businesses and have a dialogue with businesses and institutions like AICA, ELADI, CELAC, and governments should try to strengthen these institutions to ensure greater productivity and food security. And we should also try to communicate better among the region to have stronger ties of communication and trade. We are our own natural market. The Latin American region is our natural market, and we should take steps to enhance that. Would you like to add anything further? No, thank you. It has been quite a pleasure to share this time with Silvia and Cassio. Thank you, AICA, for the opportunity. Same here. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you. It has been an honor for me to share this conversation with experts in international trade such as you. Again, a very profound appreciation to AICA for asking me to participate. Remember, this is a series of seminars organized by AICA to analyze the situation of trade, agriculture, and food security in this pandemic. Thank you all.